Please be seated. Let us bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we are grateful for this opportunity to meet together and to call upon you to be present by your Holy Spirit once again, in order that you who authored your word would be here to tutor us in it and to apply it to our lives. We pray that in anticipation of our celebration of Thanksgiving, that already you would fill our hearts with gratitude, shake us out of the complacency that sometimes overtakes us, the complaining spirit, the negativity, the tendency to focus on issues and problems that discourage us, but rather to have our hearts and eyes lifted to the heavens and be amazed at the bounty of your blessing, the immeasurable grace and mercy that you have poured out upon us. And may out of that awareness of our debt to you, we offer our lives back as living sacrifices. In the name of Christ, we ask it. Amen. Well, our text this morning in Genesis chapter 12 is arguably one of the most important passages in all of Scripture when it comes to the unfolding plan of God's work of redemption. Walter Kaiser, who is the former president at Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary, has written a number of books and articles where he argues that this passage, along with a small handful of others, are absolutely foundational for our understanding of what he calls God's promise plan that unifies both Old Testament and New. He often will include Genesis 3:15 in the short list. That's God's word of curse to the serpent after the fall, in which he embeds in seed form the promise of the gospel. Then comes this passage and others connected to it elsewhere in Genesis and the life of Abraham. And then comes 2 Samuel chapter 7, where God makes a covenant with David, ultimately fulfilled in David's greater son, our Lord Jesus. And finally, Jeremiah 31, the promise of the new covenant. And just that collection of four texts, essentially, are like the mountaintop promises on which one sees the whole vista of God's work. Actually, some scholars would even go further. They would emphasize this passage and the formalizing of God's covenant with Abraham in chapter 15, the formalizing in chapter 17 of Abraham's obligatory response of obedience, and the renewal of the covenant in Genesis 22, four texts all about Abraham as being the key for understanding how the Old Testament relates to the New. It also is the point at which evangelical Christians are often at some division with one another, a dispensational view that interprets these connections one way and the more reformed view that sees the unity of them all based on the Abrahamic covenant, that's the overarching covenant. And what God did at Mount Sinai was a temporary and provisional arrangement that was symbolic, even though it was about a literal land, it was symbolic of the kingdom of heaven, which is spiritual, and gives way, as the shadow does to the reality, the promise to the fulfillment, the type to the antitype, when Jesus comes and the new covenant provides the fulfillment. So we end up being the heirs of these promises made to Abraham. In any case, these aren't just modern theologians kind of trying to put unity where there was none. It's actually a reflection of what the Apostle Paul, for example, already does when he calls our passage the gospel in advance. He calls it this in Galatians chapter 3, verse 8. He says, "The scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, and he announced the gospel in advance to Abraham, saying, all nations will be blessed through you." That it is this promise of Abraham being the instrument, the means of blessing all the nations and incorporating them into the people of God, into the Israel of God by adoption. That is the gospel in advance. And Paul isn't just saying that as a kind of throwaway line. If you look in Galatians 3, perhaps later in the day, you'll see how much he works with this passage and teases it out, its implications for us. In fact, he closes the chapter by saying, "You're all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, for all of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. There's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you're all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." You and I are the heirs. We belong to Abraham's seed, the one through whom ultimately these promises would be fulfilled corporately. In any case, so that's the excitement. Problem is, we don't have a lot of time to talk about this most important of all passages. So we're going to be only hitting highlights, but it is helpful to put it in context. First of all, just quickly, historical context. You need to think of Abraham as having lived about as many years before Christ came as we are living after Christ. The date about 2000 BC. And although that doesn't really help very much if you're not a real fan of ancient history, but with all the discoveries that have been made, particularly in the 20th century, the late 20th century, we now have a pretty good idea what life looked like during that period of time. And it wasn't just living in caves or huts. In fact, at the time of Abraham, the pyramids already were standing for half a millennium, 500 years. The great civilizations were already 1,000 years old. Literacy was actually reasonably widespread, although not as widespread as it would become under the benefit of the Canaanites, of all people, who invented the alphabet and from whom Israel got this extraordinary blessing. Undoubtedly part of the reason why God sent Abraham there in advance, so that when his word was then ready to be inscripturated, everyone could write it on the doorposts and lintels of their house, not just a few scribes that knew the alphabet of cuneiform that required never less than 600 to 800 signs to be memorized. In any case, the literary context, though, is more important. Not the history, but where it falls right here in the book of Genesis. Because when you get the literary context, when you read it in light of what comes before, Genesis 1 to 11, then you're shocked the way you should be. What God is doing to Abraham is totally unexpected. And the setup for the surprise of how God brings about this unexpected and undeserved counteroffensive, his answer to a world that was now in rebellion against him, the surprise only gets felt if you see it in light of how God dealt with sin prior to this. So let's just do a quick survey. Obviously, God begins, Genesis begins with God's work of creation, bringing out of a watery chaos order and a luxuriant world to be enjoyed and to be ruled over as a vice regent by Adam and Eve and all humanity with them. God said to Adam, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth." And so right away, there's this commission and purpose that he has in addition to imitating God himself, naming things as God had and being in covenant with his bride as God was in covenant with him. In any case, things all fell apart with the fall. And God's judgment then was expulsion to the east. When God throws Adam and Eve out of the garden, though with promises to encourage them, expelling them out of this garden to the east, setting up the cherubim at the one point of entrance, which apparently was at the east, so that they couldn't get back in. Adam and Eve's son Cain then subsequently, in this downward spiral of sin, murders his brother, Abel. And God, in response to that, judges him, curses him with frustration and meaninglessness and difficulty, but also expelling him yet further to the east and in separating him from God's own presence, is the way the language reads. So now he is removed from God's presence even more in punishment because of this. And the downward spiral continues until his seventh descendant, Lamech, is now trashing the sanctity of marriage and the sanctity of life. He is the one who invents bigamy, two wives rather than one. Because, if you're a Lamech, one wife, you got way too much love for one wife. It's got to be two. And also trashing the sanctity of life. He boasts to his two wives that if someone ever bumps into him, he bumps them off. And from Lamech, it goes from bad to worse as Genesis 6 opens up. And the Bible tells us, God, viewing the matter, now it's polygamy, rampant polygamy, men taking as many wives as they want, particularly these self-styled sons of God who are kings, the pharaohs, the great leaders of the ancient Near East that sealed many of their relationships with marriages, multiple ones. But also that the world is now full of violence. It's trashing the sanctity of marriage and the sanctity of life. And God has had it, and now comes the flood. God's response to the downward spiral of sin, ultimately, is then cleanse the world with a cleansing judgment, as we were reminded in the baptism. Do it both, and start afresh. And sure enough, on the other side of wiping out humankind, now we have Noah as a kind of second Adam with three sons like the first, and with God saying to him, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And you remember hearing that before. But again, Adam has a fall. Noah has a fall that reminds you of Adam. It involves nakedness and all the rest, and an item of consumption and that causes him, in the case of this wine, to become drunk. And anyway, his own version of the fall, and things start heading in a downward spiral after this. And in Genesis 11, right before we get to our text, we're at the bottom of the cesspool. We now have a people at the Tower of Babel who, in their kind of self-deifying effort, having arrived at advanced technology, having learned that you can use bricks instead of rock, you can use tar instead of mortar, and you can build a tower in a flat land that would be like a mountain. You can make your own mountain and make it look, well, like a step pyramid with its sky top in the sky in the heavens, and go up and bring God down to bless the deity to bless your mess. In any case, you're wondering, what's God going to do now? They want to make a name for themselves, and in a grasping effort, well, like actually Cain did the same thing. He built a city, named it after his son Enoch, and we learn that they're trying to make a name for themselves as well. What's God going to do? Chapter 12. You're expecting curse, and what do you find? A flood of blessing. All this blessing, five times over in two verses, we have the word bless, 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 repeated so you can't miss it. Bless, a word that is characteristic of the book of Genesis. God blessed the animals and blessed Adam and Eve back in the opening chapters. He blessed Noah as well. And now we're on to another blessing. This time it's for Abraham and ultimately for his seed. God's answer to curse is blessing. His answer to a city proud of itself, wanting to make a name for itself in a self-styled kind of effort at immortality, is to give to Abraham by grace what the world tried to achieve by works. I'm going to make your name great. It's not something you need to accomplish. I'll do it for you. It'll be a gift, one of the many for Abraham. In any case, that's the background of our text. And then we come to response in verse 1. The Lord had said to Abram, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I want to look at this passage and help us to see this. In this text, we have the cost of discipleship. And then we're going to look at the verse later that follows it, and we're going to look at the ground of discipleship, the reward, and hopefully the goal of it. First, the cost. First word out of God's mouth, leave. Leave. He actually said it when Abram, whose later name will be Abraham, when Abram was in the city of Ur. And we're being reminded of it here, and obviously the word still applies to Haran. And in Bible study Bibles, you often get these maps that will depict where Ur is in relation to Haran. And more recent ones get it half right. They get it half right because they include two, and that means one or the other will probably be this case. Either Abram starts with Ur, which is way down in southern Mesopotamia, right at the Persian Gulf where the Euphrates hits the Persian Gulf. That's the possible Ur that most people were aware of until recently. But in 1975, and then subsequently in other studies, it's been found that there was actually an Ur up north right next to Haran. And this answers the question people had often wondered about. Why would Abraham be called to leave Ur, then go all the way up the Euphrates, and then another 100 miles up the Balik River tributary to stay at a motel, then backtrack down the tributary to continue on to the Promised Land? It's a very strange map when you actually look at it. Secondly, Ur of the southern Ur was never called Ur of the Chaldees. The Chaldeans at the time of Abraham were living way up north. So now at a discovery made in the city of Ebla and tablets there, we have a reference to Ur of Haran, and I'd say it's undoubtedly there. But wherever it is, leaving is tough. How many of you in the congregation, just out of interest, have come to Greater Boston having left a community that is a minimum of 500 miles away? Raise your hand. 500 miles away. Wow, look at that. Do we ever feel sorry for you? Because, of course, we know what that involves. I mean, leaving Cambridge to come to Boston is enough of a culture shock. But wherever you came from, it was probably the heartland of America. You're not used to the political climate around here. You know, everything looks different. You don't like snow. And here you everything about where your home was only seems to be highlighted by how different it is in New England. It is no different for Abraham. Out of all of you, how many of you left for Boston when you were 75 or above? You know, when you're 75 and above, and his wife, he robbed the cradle, Sarai was 65. When you're 65 or 75, you're okay with taking a trip, you know, a bus leaf peeping tour of the, you know, colors of New Hampshire. But you want a gentle ride and you want to come back home, or maybe it's a cruise on the Mediterranean, or what. But it's only just to visit. No one's looking to get uprooted at those ages. You don't want to learn a new language as Abram would have needed to do. There would be a relationship. He would have been speaking probably an old Akkadian where he was living, and now he's going to have to learn Amorite, and those are sister languages, lots of shared vocabulary. But it would be like moving from German-speaking Europe to Dutch-speaking Europe. They're close, but they're not close enough. And who wants to learn a new language when you're 75? In addition, of course, there's the difference of how everything looks. We actually know that in the area of Haran and the Ur of Haran, you're in a very verdant valley. Just everything is lush, growing well, the most habitable spot. The seasons are just so great there. And suddenly you're going to be in Canaan, where things are a lot tougher, of course. And you're in an area where over 1,000 years of civilization have happened. The cities, the monumental architecture at Haran is amazing. by comparison to the stuff you're going to encounter in Canaan. And for Abraham, it's worse than that, because when he leaves his home, he's now going to be living in a tent. You know, he wasn't wanting to camp out, you know, for the rest of his life. But he doesn't have the ability to build and own a place because he's an outsider. And outsider is written all over him. He can't pronounce the words properly. People have, well, where'd you come from? You sound strange. You're an immigrant? I thought we had a wall to keep you guys out. Or, you know, I mean, so here he is, you know, going into a situation that is, well, maybe some of you can easily identify with, unless you're a homebody, you can understand the terrible price. By the way, we do have from a nearby city of Ebla, now found in 1974-75, over 20,000 cuneiform tablets. They had ancient libraries, amazing libraries, nothing comparable in Canaan. If you'd like a public library, you came to the wrong place at this point. But up there, they had an amazing library. In fact, it collapsed at the end of the destruction of the city so that the shelves all fell on top of each other. And 1,800 of the tablets are in perfect shape and in exactly correct order. And in these tablets, you have administrative texts. You learn that textiles, foods of various kinds, including wine, etc., were being passed through Haran. The name of the city is Business Center. Haran was like a center of commerce. And we have evidence of imports coming from Afghanistan, right across in a east-west highway, going through Haran, going from there to Ebla, going from Ebla to Ugarit on the Mediterranean coast, going from there to Cyprus, a distance of 2,000 miles with everything passing through Haran, and stuff coming up from Babylon to Haran and going to Cyprus. 2,000 miles, that's like from here to Salt Lake City, Utah, all coming through this city that God says, leave to go to a country bumpkin place, Canaan, where, why would you go there? All his friends said, have you read the travel journals? And you know, in fact, the State Department is warning about if you have a wife that's attractive, you know, it's dangerous. It's a dangerous community, as it turned out actually to be. Leave your country, your people, your father's house. Your father's house or household. Any time you have a loss, of course, it's terrible. Well, in the case of Abram, he's already lost a brother who's died, whose name was Haran. It's spelled the same as the city, but not in Hebrew. It has a different H. But he lost his brother already, so now he has to take care of his nephew Lot because his brother died back there in Ur. In fact, died in front of his father is a way, at least one way the text can be translated. And now his father has died. His uncle is still alive. His brother, other people and the members of the family are still alive. Mother, we don't know about. But your family is there. And now you're going to leave them too. And you're never going to come back because it's an entire month's journey to get to this place. Well, in any case, it's the cost of discipleship. It's a cost with which all of us ought to be familiar, and God himself is familiar. The reason for the repetition threefold is, in fact, to show that God understands how costly this is. He could have just said, leave Ur, leave Haran, but instead you get the repetition, leave your country, your people, your father's house. All you have to say is leave. But he says it three times over, in the same way that he says leave again at chapter 22 when it comes to offering up Isaac, his son. Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. All you had to say was Isaac, God. But God enters feelingly into it because he knows what it's going to cost him to give up his son, his only begotten son, the son that he loves for the sake of ruined sinners. And so the repetition that seemed redundant to you, it's not redundant when it's your son. And it's not redundant when it's your country, your background, your family, all the things you count dear that you're now being asked to give up. He gave it up. And he gave it up for what? Go to a land I will show you. Why doesn't God tell us where you're going? Why don't you get to plug it into the GPS? You know, just tell me, Hebron, Canaan, I got it. Why is life like that when you're following the Lord, that you don't get the destination? You just get, go to a place I'm going to show you. And by the way, in Genesis 22, it's the same way. Take your son, your only, and I'll show you where, one of the mountains. I'm not telling you now. It's always like that, isn't it? You've got to walk by faith and not by sight. You got to wait on the Lord to tell you one step at a time. And of course, all of this is an anticipation of what Abram's children, the children of Israel, are going to experience in their wilderness wandering. They don't get the end point either. All they get is today's instructions. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commandments. He humbled you, causing you to hunger. That's part of his leading. He actually brought you to a place where there's no food. And then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. It's to teach us dependence on him, not just set it into the GPS and our lives are on cruise control until we get to our destination 10 years from now. We don't get the end point. Or if you think, I sense that the end point is, I'm going to do this, this is where my life's going to go, I guarantee you're going to be wrong. Take it one day at a time as the Lord leads you, because that's what faith is about. It isn't getting all the answers ahead of time and then navigating your life without his help. Go is the cost of discipleship. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew, and they were casting a net in the lake, and they were fishermen. And he said, "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." And at once they left their nets and followed him. So the leaving sometimes isn't even leaving a place, it's leaving the stuff. It's leaving the career. It's leaving whatever God says you've got to leave. Then he went a little further and he saw the brothers of the sons of Zebedee, James and John. He called them and immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. Then he saw a tax collector by the name of Levi sitting at his tax booth. "Follow me," Jesus said to him. And Levi got up and left everything and followed him. At this, the disciples, of course, seeing this pattern a little later on, particularly when it's the rich young ruler that's told to leave all his wealth, give it away, and then come follow him, they boasted that, "Hey, Lord, we've left everything to follow you." "I tell you the truth," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life." Yes, God says, leave it. But he's going to take care of you, and you get 100-fold, even in this life. And in the life to come, you get eternal life. It's leaving in order to get to keep, to get way more. But it starts with leaving. It starts with putting it all on the altar for Christ, or you haven't yet surrendered your life to him. There's more that he wants. If it's not on the altar, you're holding back. You're to take up your cross and follow him. "We live by faith, not by sight," Paul writes. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight," Proverbs puts it. It's not about physical geography. It's not necessarily leaving Boston now. It's leaving the old life, because the destination that we are going to is an eternal kingdom, a kingdom of heaven. It's take up your cross and follow him, but you don't have to do it over in the Holy Land and head into Jerusalem like he did. It's not literalistic geography. It's letting go and denying yourself, which is what taking up your cross refers to, putting others' interests before your own, just as Christ put ours before his own when he went to the cross. That's the leaving that counts, because the path you're going on isn't a path from Boston to Boise. It's a path from this world to the next. It's allowing Christ to be the Lord of your life and to live out the rest of your life here as a pilgrim, as a sojourner with your citizenship in heaven. I've often told you, Paul writes, that before now, and now I say it again with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. It's not an actual place. Their God is their stomach. Their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven. So our lives are reoriented. We are like those who buy something. We live as if it were not ours to keep. It's all in an open hand. And there are many in this church that are amazing examples of it. And of course, in this missions conference, we're particularly mindful of this. When people are pledging to support the missions program, they have resources that they know aren't theirs. God gave them the work. God gave them the ability. God gave them the job. God gave them the salary, the inheritance, whatever it is. And it's all in an open hand. We have the things of this world that we use, but not as engrossed in them. For this world in its present form is passing away. And meanwhile, we live as aliens and strangers here. And why do we do it? Well, it's, of course, all grounded in the Word of God. It's based on what he says. He spoke to Abram. The Lord said to Abram, leave your children. It wasn't just the feeling that he had. Gee, I think I should be leaving my country or whatever. God said it. Abraham was a prophet. He heard a voice that others would hear. Sometimes it said the angel of the Lord spoke to him out of heaven, not out of his thinking, not even in a dream. And you and I have the prophetic word made more sure. It even as the Israelites heard God actually directing them to teach them that man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds on the mouth of God. Now we've got that word written. And so we imitate Jesus, who had a better relationship with the Father than any of us will ever have. Yet, when he has to respond to the temptations of the evil one, what does he do? He quotes scripture, including, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. He could have said, well, I just sense this wouldn't be right, Satan. He doesn't have to do that. The word nails it. In fact, Jesus, with the closest relationship to the Father it is possible to have, 1 out of 10 of the verses in red letters in your New Testament, if you have a red letter edition of the Gospels, 1 out of 10 are direct quotes of the Old Testament. And so at his high priestly prayer, when he prays for us, he prays, Lord, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. We're made holy. We're prepared to move into paths of righteousness based on this living, wonderful, Holy Spirit-inspired, empowered word. We don't have to just guess. And then we won't get it wrong. I have a friend, a neighbor, who felt God was calling him to leave his family and go to Utah for missions work or something. And so he left his wife there and his son, who is a dear friend of mine, and other members of the family, you know, and they tried to prevail. What are you leaving for? Well, God said to me, Where does it say that? Doesn't Jesus say that actually the Lord made the two one flesh, what God has joined together, let not man put asunder? You don't leave your wife or your children. You leave your father's household, okay, and that's what the text says. You leave your father's household. You may not be able to be around relatives and so on, but you don't go without your wife. Because the book says so. You don't leave her or him, even for a brief time, except for prayer, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 7. So it will keep you from that kind of nonsense. And what will the reward be? The reward will be what is the prerequisite for this discipleship? It's blessing. Bless, 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 bless. It's all there. You can read it. I don't have time to go through it. I want to talk about the punchline and close with that. There are seven clauses here of blessing. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. That's three. Then there are the last three. I will bless those. Whoever curses you, I will curse, because God takes our lives personally. Someone blesses you, he's blessed him. You persecute the church, Saul. You're Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? God takes everything that happens to us personally. And why? That all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. What we have here, those are the first three and the last three. I skipped the fourth clause deliberately, because I want us to see there's a concentric outline here, and that the punchline is the middle one, and that's the takeaway. In the first three, all of them having I, they're all about I. But number four is you. Then it's back to I again. The first three and the last three are all about verbs in the indicative, but not the middle one. The middle one is an imperative. It's a different form in Hebrew, and should and often is, normally is, translated that way, but not in our Bible. The first three are about what God is going to do for you. The last three are what he's going to do through you. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you. That's the plan. God's blessing you. The whole world's going to be blessed through you. The middle verse is the part that you play. And you will be a blessing is how it's translated in our Bible. But that's you got to translate that in your head. You will be a blessing is like when your mother said, you will eat your vegetables. It's not a prophecy. It's not a suggestion either. It's a command. Underline the will. You will be a blessing. And actually, it ought to be translated even more clearly as an imperative, or too many people miss it. The Geneva Bible, which is the Bible translated in English before the King James Version, and thou shalt be a blessing. Great translation. Thou shalt be a blessing. God's blessing you. Why? Thou shalt be a blessing. You're blessed in order to be a blessing, so that all the nations will be blessed, not just your family members. The American Standard Version, 1901, be thou a blessing. You hear the command? That's what it is. The New American Standard Bible, in a footnote, says, literally, why didn't they translate it this way then? Literally, be a blessing. Be a blessing. The Holman Christian Standard Bible, in a footnote, says, really, it means, so be a blessing. Why is it in the footnote? You need it to have in bold letters, so be a blessing. Will you repeat that so you'll remember it? So be a blessing. Say it again louder. So be a blessing. God is blessing you so you can be a blessing. And we can collectively, and you can individually as well. Last Sunday, we asked you to be a blessing collectively to the world as we get behind this missions program that is amazing in this church. We have 25 staff missionaries we've sent out on every continent in the world other than Antarctica. 5 global professionals. We got 24 kids of those children of those missionaries who are themselves little missionaries, if you know what children are like. And 4 midterm missionaries, all of it. All people that you should meet and can meet, many of them, so you can pray for them and find out about them. But they need our support. Last Sunday, we had 145 pledges, and we have more than $500,000, but we need another $500,000. We need another couple hundred pledges. And you know what? When I got home, I realized, to my shame, I forgot to fill out one of these pledges. I can't imagine it. Here I'm telling everyone make a pledge, and I forgot. Anyway, maybe you forgot too, so we're in good company. Today, during the offering, please, if you call this your church home, make a pledge. Pledge that you'll pray, and just say you will pray for one missionary. If every one of us just takes one, that's great, or one child of a missionary, that'd be fine. And we'll tell you who, if you want, or you suggest what continent you want. Pray for them. Make a pledge of money. If you've never pledged anything, pledge something. $5, the cost of your coffee, I don't care what. It's not really how much money. We want to be all in this together. But it needs our attention, and if you can't get it done by this offering, we're going to take it again next week, or you can put it in the boxes as you leave on each of the exits. But I want to close by saying it's not just about those missionaries out there. It's also about you and me as missionaries. Every heart with Christ is a missionary. Every heart without Christ is a mission field. You are in a mission field at the hospital, in the lab, in the workplace, wherever you are. This last week, Simon wrote to me a wonderful example of this. He has been working at a company that is a management consulting company. They work on leadership development. It's one of the biggest here in the area. And this would never happen except he's been a faithful worker, I'm guessing, well, for all 5 years he's been there. This is not something to do the first day you arrive. At work today, he writes, we had a Thanksgiving party in our kitchen space. You know, we eat together. Each person brought something to eat. As the spread was laid out and we were ready to eat, I muttered to a colleague, I really feel like saying grace. She said, why don't you? And someone else overheard her and nodded. The word somehow or other spread and everyone seemed fine. In fact, bordering on enthusiastic. So I checked. I said, I want to thank God for this, if you're okay with it. Then I bowed my head, and they all bowed their heads, and I prayed a short prayer of thanks while I was screaming with joy in my heart. What an awesome privilege. May God work the hope of Christ into their hearts. That's major. That's major. You have an opportunity with Thanksgiving to do the same with your family, your neighbors, your company, wherever it is. You can break the rules if they love you and you love them. Let's pray. Father, we pray you would bless us that we might be a blessing to all those around us. May we be like Abraham, blessing those around him by praying for them as he did for Abimelech and as he did even for Sodom and Gomorrah. We pray we would be faithful for praying for this country, for all the good things about it, that they would be strengthened, and all the things in need of correction, that they would be corrected. We pray, O God, that we would be salt and light, ambassadors of Jesus, and that we would spread blessing wherever we go. We ask in the Savior's name, amen.